Welcome, Sheila Dikshit.
Thank you.
You've been the Chief Minister of Delhi for 3 terms. That's 15 years. You've seen Delhi change, you've been part of the change, and now you're looking to be re-elected for a 4th term, mm-hmm. and that's a record in sorts. Mm. Aren't you tired? Aren't you tired of being Chief Minister for so many years and doing so much work, of course, but and looking at something wider, perhaps, on the horizon?
If and when an opportunity comes for an alternative, then I'll think about it. But I enjoy Delhi because I see it changing and being a part of that change. And there are really no full stops in Delhi. You can't say that you've done it all. Nothing else needs to be done. So it's an exciting place. And I enjoy my work. The moment I stop enjoying Delhi, I would like to voluntarily give it up if I stop.
What needs to be done? You just said that there are other things to be done.
Yes. You see, we need to carry forward what we've already done, you know, 2nd stage, 3rd stage and all. And we also need to bring in new ideas. Please remember one thing, that Delhi gets 500,000 people coming into Delhi every year. And about 1 million people come from the peripheral areas to work here. And when they come here to work from, say, the whole day, then they are using all our services here. So they, at night when they go away, they're not using our services. So it's a challenge. And we can't sit back and say, yes, we've solved all the problems. None will occur again now. They will occur. More challenges will come up. So I think we need to be vigilant.
But let's talk first about what you just mentioned, the population that moves into Delhi every mm-hmm. year. A lot of slums have come up.
Yes,
a lot of unauthorized colonies mm-hmm. have come up.
Mm-hmm.
But instead of tackling the problem in the last 15 years by building authorized colonies or flats to accommodate these people, mm-hmm. your government has only authorized the unauthorized colonies.
Mm-hmm.
And that is, in effect, allowing people to build more unauthorized colonies. Don't you think that's
No, that's one
that,
way of looking at it,
That
yes.
you should have, in fact, stopped and taken the alternative route?
No, that's one way of looking at it, that you don't do that and let them live in an illegal way. But can you just roll down about 40 lakh people who live in these houses? The real fault is, why were they allowed to come in?
But many of them came up in your tenure.
No, I'm not saying that. Why did they come up? Because they keep coming here and we're not able to cope up with housing. So therefore, in our manifesto this time, we have thought of building holding areas for those labor people who come here. We also have authorized it that, all right, let them get the taxes or whatever the government can get out of them. You can't wish them away. Secondly, we need to plan more housing. But I must tell you, one of the reasons we've not been able to go fast enough where housing is concerned is because we don't have land with us. The land is with the central government, the DDA. In fact, not even the central government, the DDA. And that's not, they don't part with land so easily. So it is a problem. It's a great challenge. But time, I'm sure in time to come or a little while later, after all, we have authorized these colonies and we've given resettlement colonies legal rights of ownership after the 70s when they were settled then. So slums come up primarily because where else do they go?
See? But you should carry on this system into the future of allowing people to have colonies and then authorizing them? Or are you going to put a full stop and say no more?
We will want to put a full stop. Can we, as a government, with not having all the powers with us, especially no land with us, can we do this as quickly as you would imagine we should do it? So it will take time.
But just going back to this mm-hmm. of you're not having all the powers of a central government, the criticism here is that why take the route of excuses? Because the central government is also your party and it's your colleagues.
No, please,
your colleagues in Congress are sitting in the center.
It's not a matter of party. It's a matter of what the system has evolved or is
so
in
is
operation.
It that, is it that
so
you don't...
So whether it's the Congress or whether it's my party or whether it's somebody else's party or whether it's somebody else's party here, That is not the issue. The issue is that land is not with you, and they're not excuses. Please, they're realities.
But even when it comes to law and order...
Now, if you want to tell us that the reality is not so, you want to wish it away, you're welcome to do that and say, well, we don't recognize this. Okay, you don't recognize it. But we do, and we have made about 40,000, 50,000 houses already, which are ready to be distributed, are being distributed.
But Mrs. Dikshit, if I may just ask you, it's the same thing with law and order. The police comes under the center, and you don't have powers of the police. You've been saying this many times in the past. So is it that you don't get the cooperation you need from your own colleagues in the central government? Is that what you're saying?
I get cooperation, but I have no say in what with the policies. Or, you know, the training pattern or whatever. I don't even have the say to, really, legally, to say, please remove this SHO from here because he's not doing good work or somebody. I don't go into all that. I'm not allowed to. It's not my job.
There is this multiplicity.
This multiplicity has been a big dampener for Delhi moving forward. But in spite of that, may I tell you, in spite of that, the way Delhi has developed in the past 15 years, it has never developed like this.
Yes, but if I may just stay with that argument of centre versus state, today you have a Congress government in the centre, and you, with the Congress, are running the state. Would it become much...
It's not a party matter, please.
No, but would it be difficult...
It's a matter of governance.
I understand.
It's not a party matter.
I understand your point
of
view.
Yes, I'm telling you...
But I want to just ask you... I just want to ask you one question. If tomorrow... the central government is run by another party, mm-hmm. let's say the BJP, mm-hmm. and you get elected as chief minister, mm-hmm. then you're going to have an even more difficult time running Delhi.
No.
Why do you say
no,
that?
No,
Why
no.
do you say that?
Please remember, Delhi is the capital of India. It's everybody's interest to see that Delhi does become the capital of a great country, of a great nation, of a huge, large nation. So there are no really conflicts. Where the conflict is that the system has been so evolved. Constitutionally, Delhi does not have the powers of a state. Till you change that constitution and you have another, whichever government comes there, it's the constitution that needs to be changed. That's why we are saying that there should be a single command system evolved where the responsibility of everything that a state has devolves on the state itself. Then you can say so. But I hate it. I feel very embarrassed to say, this is not under me, that is not under me, because it looks like an excuse, like you're saying. So that is not a happy situation, but we are saying that we've asked for it. There have been studies on the administrative system. They've all said that Delhi should get proper statehood. But till the central government, whoever it may be, decides there's nothing you and I can do about it.
In the last 15 years that you have been chief minister, you must have championed the cause of full statehood for Delhi with administrative control.
I've championed it. My assembly has championed it.
Would you say that it has been something that you could not achieve?
Yes, I couldn't.
And what makes
apart from me and my assembly doing it, there have been these three studies, the Moily Committee, the Ved Prakash Committee, and the Balakrishnan Committee, who all said that Delhi must get more powers.
So what makes you feel that there will be a change in your fourth term if you do come in?
No, I'm asking for it. I'm not giving it. If I were in the position to give it, then I would give it.
But you don't think you will be able to get it in the fourth term?
It bothers me, but it doesn't. I carry on my work. Whichever circumstances are there, whatever is the circumference of the work that I do, we carry on. And please, you may wish to run down what has happened in Delhi, but I can tell you one thing, that it has changed enormously. I mean, this is a fact which everybody, if it hadn't changed for the better, we wouldn't have been elected to three times.
Well, there is no doubt that the city has changed in 15 years. There has been a lot of good that has come about. Many people acknowledge that, but you do come under a lot of criticism as well when it comes to issues of law and order.
Always comes. There will be some people who will say yes, look at the larger picture and say, yes, it has improved. There will be some people who will say, no, nothing has happened. Well, it's all right.
Yes, but if I could complete my question, that when it comes to issues of law and order, corruption, and administrative delays, mm-hmm. that is squarely with your government.
Where the people are concerned, we have reduced administrative delays and services, the time spent on them, by making them more modern, electronically working out things. So the ordinary citizen, life is very comfortable in Delhi, and I can say that to you, whoever comes to Delhi never goes out of Delhi, back to Delhi. And it is the most comfortable city to live in. There's lots more to do, I admit that. If everything had been done, we wouldn't be seeking an election. What's the point? Everything has already been done. But to undermine what has been done, I don't accept that.
Apart from the opposition, the leading opposition party, the BJP, mm-hmm. you also have now the Aam Aadmi Party, mm-hmm. which has in many ways touched a chord with the people when it comes to corruption, price rise, and issues relating to governance. You may not be concerned about how the Aam Aadmi Party is canvassing, but at the same time, I'm sure you have an eye on what they are doing and what they're talking about.
Corruption. They said they were going to sweep corruption out. They have themselves caught into it now. And their mentor has distanced himself from them. And corruption is something that, the government of India has asked them to explain where they've got so many funds from. What is the Aam Aadmi Party? What does it stand for? It said it wouldn't go into politics. It's in politics. Okay, fine. They've come like any other party. We'll face them.
On the issue of corruption.
What corruption? I've asked you that question. Where is Aam Aadmi completely clear of corruption?
No, I'm asking you about your government.
My government has
no corruption.
Please tell me where there has been corruption. We'll take action. No corruption whatsoever. People talk
you,
of corruption.
If you want,
the word
if you want,
corruption has become a word which is used absolutely loosely. Why? Where is the corruption? Tell me.
If you feel that there is no corruption.
Not in my government.
So in your administration.
I'm talking of. No.
Yeah, I'm talking of that.
No. I'm
not talking of your government.
The corruption that may be happening at the lower level or something. I'm not going into that. But you, if
you're isn't that lower level a part of your government?
Of course it is. We are trying to do that by making administration more open. Time limits given to services that have to be given to the people. If the time limit is not adhered to, then they are fined for it. We are trying our best. We are trying to make it into an e-governed state, an open governance state. I'm not saying that. But if you are trying to imply that the government per se, as headed by the Congress, is corrupt, I staunchly say no.
But you do agree that there is corruption in the system.
Of course there is. Everybody knows that.
And the system is
just
run.
Just like I agree that the price rise is not only in Delhi, it's all over India.
But the system is run by your government.
Yes, it is. But I'm afraid you are very naive about corruption. You tell me.
Please enlighten me. How do you see it?
No, I see it that there is a system. It needs to become more open. It needs to become more people-friendly. And corruption should not be there. But I also have another point of view. The person who gets corruption is also being given corruption by another corrupt person. So it's a two-way story. Let's put the system. I'm not going to. If you give me specific instances,
all right, let's
that
give
this
you a specific,
officer did something
let,
wrong,
let,
we'll
let
take
me
action.
Give you a few. Let me give you very simple examples. Hmm. Your meter readers, your service providers, your driving light. Just a moment, let me finish. Mm-hmm. Then you can probably explain the situation as
mm-hmm.
it is.
Mm-hmm.
Let me give you specific examples. For example, somebody goes to get a driving license made.
Mm-hmm.
All right? There is a system there. It should work. It doesn't work. Why?
It needs to be set right. You give me instances. You tell me where it is. We are now. All our driving license giving offices, the MLO's offices they are called, we are going to make them e-friendly so that people just walk in, take their photographs and walk out. That has happened in 2 or 3 MLO offices already. We're going to replicate it all over. Registration offices. We have about 13, out of them 9 have been totally made e-friendly. E-governance over there, so you walk in and within 2 hours you walk out with your papers. So it's not that we are not trying. Yes, I don't have a magic wand. You won't have. Nobody would have. Yes, you do it and everything goes all right. There is corruption, no doubt about it. It's everywhere. But I'd like to know where it is. Give us instances and we'll take action. Nobody gives us instances.
So do you have a system whereby people can report to you in case
there are corrupt practices? I'm there all the time. I'm not responsible for the meter reader. The person but there who is doing it, they do ring up people whoever is doing the wrong meter reading. There are cases which are settled amicably, because corruption is not just one-sided, it's both-sided.
Not really. Let me just correct you there.
Nobody talks of the solutions that have been found. You only talk of these, the ones where we need to work.
Let me just say that what you say about corruption being both-sided is not necessarily true, because many people who are honest
people... you have an opinion, I have another one.
I'm just giving you...
I do corruption because I want my work done
Let me explain you. Let me explain you what some people feel and say.
Some people.
And let me just explain you that they would like to follow the system. They are forced. It's more or less extortion. Whereas there may be people who are paying money to get things done fast, but there are also people who have no choice, who would like to go straight, but unfortunately they are being forced, because the person in a position of power forces them that either you pay or else your work is not done.
I don't think we are going to sit here. This is a very large debate. It's all over India. It's all over the world. I don't want to get into that. And maybe some other day you come over and we'll have a debate.
Are you planning to stem this in Delhi?
Which government would like to encourage corruption? No. By making it more
so
open,
my question is,
by people knowing about it, and also getting, it's a two-way story. It may be 10 this side, it may be 5 this, the other side, but it happens because two people are conniving in it. But please, I am not really here to answer your questions on corruption. But there is corruption, I accept that. How much of it is there is something debatable. You might think it's everywhere. I might say, yes, it is not everywhere. So that's it.
Do you think that the big debate...
And there is a system where you can complain that this person is the thing. Complain and it'll be heard. That system is there also.
But nobody does it because they're also in a hurry.
So what is the big debate in your mind when it comes to this particular election? What do you think will be the issues?
The issues would be, well, let's see. We've brought out our issues, how we plan to go forward. I have yet to see the issues being done by the BJP, and the Aam Aadmi has come out with 8 or 10 issues. We won't give any, we will give water free to everybody, we will give, we will bring a Lokpal, we will have an assembly session in Ramlila ground, we will cut down 30% of power charges, all impractical. Can you have a session of the assembly in Ramlila grounds? Are you entitled to make a Lokpal bill? It's the Parliament of India which has to do it. So the premises are all wrong. We have a Lokayukta already. You do that. So what are you trying to talk? Can you give free water to everybody? Can you afford it? Can any government afford it? Can any government afford to give you 30% less in your bills? If you give them 30% less, you'd probably cut 30% electricity. So instead of having 24 hours electricity, you'll just have about 10 hours or 8 hours of cuts.
Do you think the Delhi election and your performance in it, your party's performance in it, will have any impact on the national election?
Well, let's see. Let's see how people, because take it. We are at the moment contesting the Delhi assembly elections. We are going to this with the confidence. Now, naturally, if a party wins, it boosts up everybody's morale.
A little while ago, you were probably contemplating moving to the centre.
No, I wasn't contemplating.
Well, there was talk about it. Yes.
Not my contemplation, please. I don't contemplate on what may happen. But there were people who said, yes, you are moving to the centre, you're going there, you're like... That's all right.
There were also certain people who said that perhaps you may be the prime ministerial candidate.
People said it. I haven't said it.
Right.
Neither has my party said anything about it. And unless the party and I decide, people can conjecture. That's all.
Is there any chance of that in the future?
How can I say it? The future, I'm not an astrologer. I cannot predict the future. My attention right now is that our party must win in Delhi. And that's that. After that, we'll see what happens.
Thank you so much. Thanks for sharing your views with us.
Thank you.